everyone. Welcome to another First Chapter Friday. We will be hearing this first chapter from a book that's one of my personal favorites. It's a sci-fi called Starters, and it is by Lissa. Alright, Chapter 1. Enders gave me the creeps. The doorman flashed a practiced smile as he let me into the body bank. He wasn't that old, maybe 110, but he still made me shudder. Like most Enders, he sported silver hair, some phony badge of honor of his age. Inside, the ultra-modern space with its high ceilings dwarfed me. I walked through the lobby as if gliding through a dream, my feet barely touching the marble floor. He directed me to the receptionist, who had white hair and matte red lipstick that transferred to her front teeth when she smiled. They had to be nice to me there, in the body bank, but if they saw me on the street, I'd be invisible. Forget that I had been top of my class back when there was school. I was 16, a baby to them. The receptionist's heels clicked and echoed in this stark space as she took me to a small waiting room, empty except for silver brocade chairs in the corners. They looked like antiques, but the chemical scent in the air belonged to new paint and synthetics. The so-called nature sounds of the forest birds were just as fake. I glanced at my frayed sweats and scuffed shoes. I had brushed them best I could, but the stains would not go away. And because I had tramped all the way to Beverly Hills in the morning drizzle, I was also wet as a lost cat. My feet hurt. I wanted to collapse into a chair, but I didn't dare leave a damp butt mark on the brocade. A tall Ender popped into the room, interrupting my little etiquette dilemma. "Callie Woodland?" He looked at his watch. "You're late." "Sorry, the rain?" "It's all right, you're here." He extended his hand. His silver hair seemed whiter in contrast to his artificial tan. As his smile broadened, his eyes widened, making me more nervous than usual with an Ender. They didn't deserve to be called seniors as they preferred, these greedy old fogies at the end of their lives. I forced myself to shake his wrinkled hand. "Mr. Tinnenbaum, welcome to the prime destinations." He wrapped his other palm over mine. "I'm just here to see." I looked around at the walls that I'd come to inspect, as if I had come to inspect the interior design. "How it all works? Of course, no charge for that." He grinned, and then he finally released my hand. "Why don't you follow me?" He extended his arm as if I couldn't find my way out of the room. His teeth were so bright. I flinched a little when he smiled. We walked down a short hallway to his office. "Go right in, Callie. Have a seat by the desk." He closed the door. I bit my tongue to keep from gasping at the total extravagance inside. A massive copper fountain flowed with endless water alongside one wall. The way they were letting this clear, clean water fall and splash, you'd think the stuff was free. A glass desk embedded with the LED light dominated the center of the room, with an air screen display hovering a foot above. It showed a picture of a girl my age, with long red hair, wearing gym shorts. Although she was smiling, the photo was straight on, like some full-length mugshot. Her expression was sweet, hopeful. I sat in a modern metal chair as Mr. Tinnenbaum stood behind the desk, pointing at the air display. "One of our newest members. Like you, she heard about us through a friend. The woman who rented her body, the women were quite pleased. touched the corner of the screen, changing the picture to a teen in a racing swimsuit with major abs. This fellow Adam referred her. He can snowboard, ski, and climb. He's a popular rental for our outdoorsy men who haven't been able to enjoy these sports for decades. Hearing his words made it all too real. Creepy old Enders, with arthritic limbs taking over this teen's body for a week, living inside his skin. It made my stomach flip. I wanted to bolt, but one thought kept me there. Tyler. I gripped the seat of my chair with both hands. My stomach growled. Tinnenbaum extended a pewter dish of super truffles in paper cups. My parents had had the same dish once. "Would you like one?" he asked. I took one of the oversized chocolates in silence. Then I remembered my rusty manners. "Thank you." "Take more." He waved the dish to entice me. I took a second and a third, since the dish still hovered near my hand. I wrapped them in their paper cups and slipped them into my sweatshirt pocket. He looked disappointed not to see me eat them, like I was to be his entertainment for the day. Behind my chair, the fountain bubbled and splashed, teasing me. If he didn't offer me something to drink soon, he just might get to see me with my head under the fountain slurping like a dog. "Could I have a glass of water, please?" "Of course." He snapped his fingers and then raised his voice as if speaking to some hidden device. "Glass of water for the young lady." A moment later, an Ender with the figure of a model came in, balancing a glass of water on a tray. It was wrapped in a cloth napkin. I took the glass and I saw small cubes glistening like diamonds. "Ice." She set the tray beside me and left. I tilted my head back and downed the sweet water all at once, the cool liquid running down my throat. My eyes closed as I savored the cleanest water I had had since the war ended. When I finished, I let one of the ice cubes fall into my mouth. I bit into it with a crunch. When I opened my eyes, I saw Tinnenbaum staring at me. "Would you like more?" he asked. I would have, but his eyes told me he didn't mean it. I shook my head and finished the cube. My fingernails looked even dirtier against the glass as I set it back on the tray. Seeing the ice melting in the glass reminded me of the last time I had had ice water. It seemed like forever, but it was only a year ago, the last day in our house before the marshals came. "Would you like to know how it all works?" Tinnenbaum asked. "Here at Prime Destinations." I stopped myself from rolling my eyes. Enders. Why else would I be there? I gave him a half smile and nodded. He tapped the corner of the air screen to clear it, and then a second time to bring up a hollow omission. The first one showed a senior reclining on a lounge chair, the back of her head being fitted with a small cap. Colored wires protruded from the cap and led to a computer. "The renter is connected to a BCI, body computer interface, in a room staffed with experienced nurses," he said. "Then she's put into a twilight sleep."
"Like at the dentist?"
"Yes. All her vital signs are monitored throughout the entire journey." On the other side of the screen, a teen girl reclined in a long padded chair. "You'll be put under with a kind of anesthesia. Completely painless and harmless. You wake up a week later, a little groggy, but a whole lot richer." He flashed those teeth again. I forced myself not to wince. "What happens during the week?" "She gets to be you,"
He spread his palms and rotated them. Do you know about computer assists that help amputees move fake hands? They just think about it, and it moves. It's very much like that. So she's visualizing that she's me, and if she wants something, she just thinks it, and my hand grabs it? Just like she was in your body. She uses her mind to walk your body out of here and gets to be young again. He cradled one elbow in his other hand for a little while. But how? He nodded to the other side of the screen. Over here in another room, the donor, that would be you, is connected to the computer via a wireless BCI. Wireless? We insert a tiny neurochip into the back of your head. You won't feel a thing. Totally painless. Allows us to connect you to the computer at all times. We then connect your brain waves to the computer, and the computer connects the two of you. Connects? My brow furrowed as I tried to imagine two minds connected that way. BCI. Neurochip. Inserted. This was getting creepier by the minute. That urge to run was coming back hard, but at the same time, I wanted to know more. I know, it's all so new. He gave me a condescending smirk. We make sure you're completely asleep. The renter's mind takes over your body. She answers a series of questions posed by the team to be sure everything is working the way it should. Then she's free to go enjoy her rented body. The diagram showed graphics of the rented body, playing golf, playing tennis, diving. The body retains its muscle memory, so whatever sports you've played, she'll be able to play. When the time is over, the renter walks the body back here. The connection is shut down in the proper sequence. The renter is taken off the twilight sleep drugs. She is checked over, then goes on her merry way. You, the donor, are restored to your full brain functions via the computer. You wake in your body as if you'd been sleeping for several days. What if something happens to me while she's in my body? Snowboarding, skydiving? What if I get hurt? Nothing like that has ever happened here. Our renters sign a contract that makes them financially liable. Believe me, everyone wants that deposit back. He made me sound like a rental car. A chill went through me like someone had run an ice cube up my spine. That reminded me of Tyler, the only thing keeping me in that chair. What about the chip? I asked. That's removed after your third rental. He handed me a sheet of paper. Here, this might put you at ease. Rules for renters at prime destinations. You may not alter the appearance of your rental body in any way, including, but not limited to, piercings, tattoos, hair cutting, or dyeing, cosmetic, contact lenses, and any surgical procedures, including augmentation. No changes to teeth are allowed, including fillings, removal, and embedded jewelry. You must remain inside a 50-mile perimeter around prime destinations. Maps are available. Any attempt to tamper with the chip will result in immediate cancellation without refund. The fines will be levied. If you have a problem with your rental body, return to prime destinations as soon as possible. Please treat your rental with care. Remember at all times that it is an actual young person. Be advised that each neurochip blocks renters from engaging in illegal activities. The rules did not make me feel any better. They brought up more problems I hadn't even considered. What about other things? I asked. Like what?
I don't know. I wish he wasn't going to make me say it, but he was.
Sex?
What about it?
There's nothing in the rules, I said.
I sure didn't want my first time to happen when I wasn't even there.
He shook his head.
That's made quite clear to the renters. It is forbidden.
Yeah, right. At least pregnancy would be impossible. Everyone knew that it was a side effect, hopefully temporary, of vaccination. My stomach tightened. I shook the hair back from my eyes and stood.
Thanks for your time, Mr. Tenenbaum, and the demonstration.
His lip twitched. He tried to cover it with a half smile.
If you sign today, there's a bonus.
He pulled a form out of his drawer and scribbled on it, and then he slid it across the desk.
That's for 3 rentals.
He capped his pen. I picked up the contract. That money could buy us a house and food for a year. I sat back down and I took a deep breath. He held out the pen. I grabbed it.
3 rentals? I asked.
Yes, and you'll be paid upon completion. The paper waved. I realized my hand was shaking.
It's a very generous offer, he said. That's with the bonus if you sign today.
I needed that money. Tyler needed it. As I gripped the pen, the bubbling of the fountain got louder in my head. I was staring at the paper, but I saw flashes of the matte red lipstick, the eyes of the doorman, Mr. Tenenbaum's unreal teeth. I pressed the pen to the paper, but before I made a mark, I looked up at him. Maybe I wanted one last reassurance. He nodded and smiled. His suit was perfect, except for a piece of white lint on his lapel. It was shaped like a question mark. He was so eager. Before I knew it, I put the pen down. His eyes narrowed.
Something wrong?
It's just something my mother always said.
What was that?
She said, always sleep on an important decision. I have to think about it.
His eyes went cold. I can't promise this offer will be good later.
I'll have to take my chances. I folded the contract into my pocket and I rose from the chair. I forced a little smile.
Can you afford to do that? He stepped in front of me.
Probably not, but I have to think about it. I moved around him and walked to the door.
Call if you have questions, he said a little too loudly.
I rushed past the receptionist, who seemed upset to see me leaving so soon. She followed me with her eyes as she punched what I imagined was a panic button. I kept going. The doorman stared at me through the glass door before opening it.
Leaving already?
His hollow expression was ghoulish. I bolted past him. Once I was outside, the brisk fall air hit my face. I breathed it in. As I wove through the crowds of enders packing the sidewalk, I must have been the only one who had ever turned Tenenbaum down, who didn't fall for his pitch. But I'd learned not to trust enders. I walked through Beverly Hills, shaking my head at the pockets of wealth that remained over a year after the war had ended. Here, only every third storefront was vacant. Designer wear, visual electronics, and bot shops, all for the wealthy Ender's shopping fix. Scrounging was good here. If anything broke, they'd just throw it away because there was no one to fix it and no way to get parts. I kept my head down. Even though I wasn't doing anything illegal at the moment, if a marshal stopped me, I couldn't produce the necessary docs that claimed minors had to carry. As I waited for a traffic light, a truck stopped with a bunch of glum starters, dirty and battered, sitting cross-legged in the back, picks and shovels piled in the center. One girl with a bandage around her head stared at me with dead eyes. I saw the flicker of jealousy in them, as if my life were any better. As the truck pulled away, the girl folded her arms, sort of hugging herself. As bad as my life was, hers was worse. There had to be some way out of this insanity, some way that didn't involve that creepy body bank or legalized slave labor. I stuck to the side streets, avoiding Wilshire Boulevard, which was a martial magnet. Two enders, businessmen in black raincoats, walked toward me. I looked away, and I slipped my hands inside my pockets. In my left pocket was the contract. In my right, the paper-wrapped chocolates. Bitter and sweet. The neighborhoods became rougher the farther I got from Beverly Hills. I sidestepped piles of garbage, waiting for pickups that were long overdue. I looked up and realized I was passing a building that was red-tented, contaminated. The last spore missiles had been over a year ago, but the hazmat teams hadn't gotten around to purging this house, or didn't want to. I held my sleeve to cover my nose and my mouth, as my dad had taught me, and hurried away. Daylight faded away, and I moved more freely. I pulled out my little hand light and strapped it to the back of my left hand, but didn't turn it on. We'd broken the street lights here. We needed the protection of the shadows so that authorities couldn't pick us up with one of their lame excuses. They'd be only too happy to lock us in institutions. I'd never seen the inside of one, but I heard about them. One of the worst, Institution 37, was just a few miles away. I'd heard other starters whisper about it. By the time I was a couple of blocks from our home, it was dark as it got. I flicked on my hand light. A minute later, I caught the streaking of two hand lights starting at an angle, coming from the other side of the road, because whoever it was kept their hand lights on. I hoped that they were friendlies. But then, at the same second, the lights both went dark. Renegades. My stomach tightened and my heart leapt to my throat. I ran. I had no time to think. My instinct took me toward my building. One of them, a tall, long-legged girl with a tattoo on the side of her face, caught up to me. She was right behind me, reaching out to grab my sweatshirt. I pumped my legs harder. The side door to my building was just halfway down the block, waiting for me. She tried again, and this time got my hood. I fell as she yanked me, and I landed hard on the sidewalk. My back hurt, and my head stung. She straddled me and went for my pockets. Her friend, a smaller boy, turned his hand light back on and aimed it into my eyes. "I don't have any money." I squinted and I tried to slap her hands away. She hit the side of my face with her open palms, smacking my ears hard, a dirty street trick that made your head ring with pain. "No money for me," she said, her muffled words reverberating in my head. "Then you're in it deep." A rush of adrenaline powered my arm, and I punched her across the jaw. She started to fall over, but righted herself before I could get out from under her. "You're dead now, baby," I squirmed and thrashed, but she locked me down with her steel thighs. She pulled back her fist and put her whole body into it. I rolled my head to the side at the last second, and her fist connected with the pavement. She screamed. Her scream propelled me to scramble out from under her while she cradled her hand in pain. My heart was pounding like it wanted to leap out of my chest. The other kid moved in with a rock. My breath came in gulps as I got to my feet. something fell from my pocket. Everyone stopped to look. Precious super truffles. Food! Her friend shouted as he aimed his light on it. The girl crawled toward it, protecting her crushed hand against her chest. Her friend dove to the ground and snatched it up. She grabbed for his hand, broke off a piece of the truffle, and gobbled it down. He devoured the rest. I ran for the side entrance of my building. I pushed open the door, my door, and ducked inside. I prayed they wouldn't enter my building. I had to depend on them being too scared of my friendlies and any traps I might have set. I aimed my hand light to check out the stairs. Clear. I climbed to the third floor and peered through a dirty window. Below, the renegade thieves scurried away like vermin. I took a quick inventory. The back of my head hurt from hitting the pavement, but I had made it without any bad gashes or broken bones. I put my hand on my chest and I tried to calm my breathing. I turned my attention to the inside of the building, and I did my usual scans. I listened as best I could, but my ears were still ringing from the fight. I shook my head to try to clear them. No new sounds. No new occupants. No danger. The office on the end drew me like a beacon, promising sleep. Our encampment of desks barricaded the corner, sealing off a section of the cavernous bare room and providing the illusion of comfort. Tyler was probably already asleep. I fingered the remaining super truffles in my pockets. Maybe I should just surprise him in the morning. But I couldn't wait. Hey, wake up! I caught something for you! When I came around the desks, nothing was there. No blankets. No brother. Nothing. What few belongings we had were gone. Tyler? I called out. My throat tightened as I held my breath. I dashed for the door, but just as I got there, a face popped in through the doorway. Michael! Michael shook back his shaggy blonde hair. Callie! He put his hand light under his chin and aped a scary face. He couldn't hold it and broke into laughter. If he was laughing, Tyler had to be all right. I gave him a little shove. Where's Tyler? I asked. I had to move you guys to my room. The roof started leaking in here. He aimed his light at a dark blot on the ceiling. Hope that's okay. Don't know. Depends on your decorating skills. I followed him to a room across the hall. In two different corners, the desks formed cozy protective nooks. As I got closer, I saw he had recreated the exact arrangement of our belongings. I went inside the nook in the far corner and I saw Tyler sitting against the wall, blanket over his legs. He looked too small for his 7 years. Maybe it was the momentary thought of losing him, or the fact that I'd been away all day. But it was like seeing him anew. He had lost weight since we had been on the streets. His hair needed cutting. Shadows darkened the skin under his eyes. Where you been, monkey face? Tyler's voice was hoarse, and I made an effort to push away a look of concern. Out! You've been gone a long time, but you have Michael here. I knelt beside him. And it took me a long time to find a special treat for you. A slight smile formed on his lips. What'd you get me? I pulled out one of the paper cups and unwrapped the vitamin-infused chocolate. It was the size of a cookie. His eyes widened. Super truffle? He looked at Michael standing near me. Wow! I've got two. I showed him the other one. Both for you. He shook his head. You have one, but you need the vitamins, I said. Did you eat today? He asked. I stared at him. Could I get away with a little lie? No, He knew me too well. You guys share it, Tyler said. Michael shrugged and his hair fell over one eye in that beautiful, effortless way that defined him.
Can't argue with that,
Tyler smiled and held my hand. Thanks, Callie. We ate the super truffles, sitting around a desk placed in the middle of the room. It served as our dining table, with Michael's hand light in the center, set a candle mode. We cut the chocolate into small pieces and joked about the first bite being an appetizer, the second an entree, and the third a dessert. They were heaven. The sweet, thick chocolates, a cross between brownies and fudge, rich and smoky on our tongues. They were gone too soon. Tyler perked up after eating. He sang some song to himself while Michael leaned his chin on one hand and stared at me from across the desk. I knew he was dying to ask me about the body bank, and maybe more. I saw his eyes scan my new scrapes and cuts. The truffles made me thirsty, I said.
Me too,
Tyler said. Michael rose.
I guess I better fill up the water bottles.
He grabbed our bottles, which hung on straps by the door, along with our washing pail, and then he left. Tyler put his head on the desk. The excitement of the chocolates was taking its toll. I rubbed his baby soft hair, his neck. His hoodie had slipped off one shoulder, exposing his vaccination scar. I ran my fingers over it, grateful for the little mark. If not for that, we'd all be dead, like our parents, like everyone between 20 and 60. We, like the elderly elders, were the most vulnerable, so we had gotten the vaccinations first against the genocide spores. Now we were the only ones left. How ironic was that? After a few minutes, Michael returned with the filled water bottles. I went to the bathroom where he'd left the pail. The first week we had lived there, we still had running water in the building. I sighed. It used to be so much easier than stealing our water from outside pipes when no one was looking. The cold water felt refreshing, even though it was November and there was no heat in the building. I splashed water onto the cuts on my arms and my face. When I returned to the room, Tyler was settled back in our corner. Michael was lying in his mirror image fort in the opposite corner. I felt safer with all of us in the same room. If anyone were to break in, one of us would have the intruder from behind. Michael had a metal pipe. I had a mini zip taser that had belonged to my father. It wasn't as strong as a Marshall's, but I relied on it. Sad how it had become my new comfort item. I sat on my sleeping bag and I pulled off my shoes. I took off my sweatshirt and slipped into my sleeping bag as if I were going to sleep. I added pajamas to my internal list of things that I missed. Flannel warm from the dryer. I was tired of always being dressed, ready to run or fight. I ached for fluffy jammies and a deep forget-the-world sleep. Michael moved our stuff over. Tyler shined his light at our books and treasures on the desk surrounding us. I know, that was nice of him. He aimed his light at a toy dog, just like before. At first I thought he meant like our home, but then I realized he meant how we had had it the previous day. Michael had made a point of arranging our possessions exactly as we'd had them. He knew how precious they were to us. Tyler pulled down our hollow frame. He did this every few nights. When he felt particularly sad, he held it in his palm and cycled through the hollows. Our family at the beach, us playing in the sand, our dad at target practice, our parents at their wedding. My brother paused at the same place as he always did. An image of our parents on a cruise taken 3 years ago. just before the fighting started in the Pacific Ocean. The sound of their voices was always hard for me. "We miss you, Tyler. We love you, Callie. Take good care of your brother." The first month I cried whenever I heard their voices, and then I stopped. They sounded hollow now, like nameless actors. Tyler never cried. He continued to absorb their words over and over. This was Mom and Dad to him now. "Okay, enough. Time to sleep." I reached for the frame. "No, I want to remember." His eyes pleaded with me. "You afraid you'll forget?" "Maybe." I tapped the hand light on his wrist. "Remember who invented this?" Tyler nodded solemnly, his lower lip extended.
"Dad?"
"That's right, with some other scientists. So whenever you see the light from it, think of it as Daddy watching over you."
"That's what you do?"
"Every day." I stroke his head. "Don't worry, I promise we'll never ever forget them." I traded the frame for his favorite toy, only toy now, a small dog bot. He tucked it in under his arm and went to soft mode, lying like a real dog, except for the glowing green eyes. I put the frame back on the desk above us. Tyler coughed. I pulled his sleeping bag up around his neck. Every time he coughed, I struggled not to hear the clinic doctor's words echo in my mind. "Rare lung disorder. Might heal or not." I watched Tyler's chest rise and fall and heard the labored breathing of sleep take over. I crawled out of my sleeping bag and peered around the desks. Michael's hand light glowed against the wall. I threw my sweatshirt over my shoulders and padded over. "Michael," I whispered. "Come on in." He kept his voice hushed. I entered his little fortress. I liked being there, surrounded by his pencil and charcoal drawings, his art supplies filling every nook. He drew city scenes, interpreting our landscape of empty buildings, friendlies and renegades, complete with hand lights and layering, ragged clothes, water bottle slung across, thin torsos. He put down his book and sat up with his back to the wall, motioning for me to sit next to him on his army blanket.
"So, what happened to your face?"
I reached up to my cheek. It was burning. "Does it look bad?"
"Tyler didn't notice." "Only because it's so dark in here."
I sat cross-legged, facing him.
"Renegades?"
I nodded. "Yeah, but I'm okay."
"How was that place?"
"Weird." He went silent. His head hung down.
"What?"
I asked.
Michael raised his head. "I was worried you weren't coming back."
"I promised, didn't I?" He nodded.
"Yeah, but I was thinking, what if you couldn't come back?"
I had no response to that. We sat a moment until he finally broke the silence.
"So, what'd you think of it?"
"Did you know they insert a neurochip in here?" I pointed to the back of my head.
"Where? Let me see."
He touched my hair.
"I told you, I just went to check it out."
I saw the concern in his face, his eyes soft with kindness. Funny, I hadn't really noticed him much when he lived down the street from us. Strange that it had taken the spore wars to bring us together. I stuffed my hands into my pockets and I felt something. A paper. I pulled it out.
"What's that?"
he asked. "The man at the body bank gave it to me. It's a contract." Michael leaned closer.
"That's what they're going to pay?"
He snatched the form from my fingers.
"Give it back."
He read the contract.
"For 3 connections?
I'm not doing it."
"Good."
He paused.
"But why? I know you. You're not scared."
"They'll never pay that money. It's unreal." That's what tipped me off.
How do they get around the law anyway, hiring starters? I shrugged. They must have some loophole. It's pretty much off the radar. You never see any ads for it. He was right. The only way I knew about it was from that guy who used to live on the first floor. He probably makes money for every starter he brings in. He won't be getting any from me. I rested on my side, leaning my head on my hand. I don't trust that place. You must be tired, he said. That was a long walk. I am beyond tired. Tomorrow, let's go to the loading dock and see if we can get some food. His words faded, and my eyes felt heavy. Next thing I knew, I opened my eyes, and he was smiling at me. Cal, he said gently, go to bed. I nodded. I stuffed the contract back into my pocket and returned to Tyler. My body melted into the sleeping bag. I set my light to sleep mode. It glowed softly. Winter in Southern California wasn't brutal, but it was going to get too cold for Tyler. I needed to get him into someplace warm, a real home. But how? This was my nightly ritual worry. I'd hoped the body bank would be the answer, but it wasn't. As I drifted off to sleep, my light turned itself off. My sleep was shattered by the screech of a smoke detector. A bitter stench filled my nostrils. I felt Tyler near me, sitting up and coughing. Michael! I called out. Fire! He shouted from across the room. The time on my headband read 5 a.m. I felt for my water bottle and opened it. I reached into the drawer above me and pulled out a t-shirt. I splashed water on it. Hold this to your nose, I told Tyler. Michael's light broke through the smoke. Let's go, he shouted. I locked arms with my little brother, our hand lights partly penetrating the smoke as we all crouched over and made our way to the door. Michael put his hand on my back, guiding me to the stairs. Smoke clouded the stairway. It seemed to take forever, but we made it down. My legs were rubbery by the time we made it outside. We stepped away from the building, worried about flames and falling debris. In the darkness of the early morning, we saw other friendlies coming out. Two we knew, and three others, who must have been on the lower floors. They were staring at the building in shock. I spun around. Where are the flames? I asked. Where's the fire? Michael said. Is that everyone? A man yelled. Yeah. I saw an Ender, maybe 100 years old, approaching. He wore a crisp suit. You sure? The Ender looked at the friendlies, who nodded. Good. The man raised his hand, and three more Enders wearing construction gear walked forward. One construction man ripped off the tape that covered the lock on the side door. Another used a hand tool to post a notice. The suit gave us a copy of the notice. Michael read it. No trespassing. Premises under new ownership. They smoked us, one of the friendlies said. You must vacate the area now, the suit said in a calm but authoritative voice. When no one moved, he added, you have 1 minute. But our stuff! I moved toward the building. I can't let you back in there. Insurance liability, the suit said. You can't keep our property, Michael said. Squatting is trespassing, the Ender said. I'm warning you for your own good. 30 seconds. My heart sank. All we have left of our things is in there. If we can't go in, please just bring our stuff out. He shook his head. There's no time. You have to go. The marshals are on their way. That made the other friendlies run. I put my arm around Tyler and turned to go, but something made me stop. The man in the suit already had his back to us, but the construction man saw us and nodded to him.
He turned.
Please, our parents are dead. My eyes burned with tears. The last pictures we have of them are inside the building, on the third floor end of the hall. Could someone just give us the frame, even if they have to throw it out the window? He paused for just a moment, as if he were considering it.
I wish I could, but I can't. Sorry.
He turned his back. I never felt so hollow inside. It was hopeless arguing with him. More than 100 years separated us. He could never understand what we'd gone through.
Callie, it's okay.
Tyler pulled my hand.
We can remember them without pictures. We won't forget.
Sirens blared.
It's the marshals, Michael said. Run!
We had no choice. We ran to the darkness of early morning, leaving behind the last physical links to our family and to the life we'd lived together just a year ago. As you guys can surmise, Callie does go back to the prime destinations, and the rest of the story is quite exciting. I hope you enjoyed this reading. I'm sorry I kept having coughing fits. You have a great day, and see you next Friday.